Gospel is recorded by St. Mark, chapter 1. Mark chapter 1, verses 1 through 13. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophets, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." John came baptized in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And all the land of Judea and those from Jerusalem went out to him and were all baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "There comes one after me who is mightier than I, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to stoop down and loose. I indeed baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." And it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And immediately coming up from the water, he saw the heavens parting and the Spirit descended upon him like a dove. Then a voice came from heaven, "You are my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And immediately the Spirit drove him into the wilderness. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and with the wild beasts, and the angels ministered to him. May the Lord's rich blessing be to his word, and may it be sanctified in our hearts. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word, for the interest of your word gives light. Lord, we pray you open your word to us, that we might see the Lord Jesus Christ in all of his majesty, and all of his splendor, and all of his glory. Your word will minister to our hearts, our minds, our souls, and our spirits, and that your word might speak to that person, Lord, who is in the greatest of need to know you as their personal Savior. We'll be ever so careful to give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. For it's in Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We're going to begin a series this morning of messages from the Gospel of Mark. And the theme of the Gospel of Mark is the service of the servant. Well, Jesus Christ is presented as the servant of the Lord. And this morning, we're going to be talking about the preparation for the servant's ministry. Now, those of you who are very familiar with the Bible, you know the Bible is broken down into two major pieces, the Old Testament and the New Testament. And the Old Testament covers the period of God's record from the beginning of creation in the book of Genesis until the book of Malachi, which is the final book of the Old Testament, when the Old Testament canon closes. And in between there, you have the law of God, you have the prophets, you have the Psalms, you have the wisdom literature, and you have the history of God's dealing with the children of Israel as a national entity. And how when they obeyed the Lord, they were blessed. When they disobeyed, God chastised them and God disciplines them. And as the Old Testament closes, the children of Israel are a scattered people. They are not a national entity. They are no longer a sovereign state. They're under the jurisdiction of different nations as time passes. But the Old Testament closes with the book of Malachi. And it closes with a great promise that God was going to send a messenger. And this messenger would go before the Messiah. He would go before the king that God would send to Israel. And so that's the way the Old Testament closes. And the New Testament opens up. And there's a 400-year gap that the theologians refer to that time of silence, where there was no direct prophetic word that God gave that was written down and contained in biblical canon or biblical scripture, a 400-year period gap between Malachi and between Matthew. And so as the book of Matthew opens up, and Jesus is presented as being the king of the Jews. But the order of the New Testament is not the order in which the books were actually written and actually canonized. The scholars put the New Testament in the order that would make sense. So it made sense that if you were trying to present Jesus Christ as the Son of God, that you would put the first book would be the book that closely connected to the last Old Testament book and the book that gave his genealogy and gave his birth. And that's why Matthew is first in the New Testament canon. Matthew was probably not the first gospel that was written. But the scholars put it first in terms of order, and the way they ordered the first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they were put in the order that would bring some order to the presentation of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so the first four books of the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are referred to as the gospels. And the gospels, they deal with the good news. And the gospels deal with the life and the ministry, the betrayal, the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so as the New Testament is being presented to us, it's first and of paramount importance that we understand the centrality of the life, the death, and the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Because if we don't understand that Jesus is preeminent in the New Testament, that he's preeminent in the church, and that everything associated in the church, it derives from the life and the ministry, the sacrificial death and burial and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So before we can get to fully understand the significance of the church, we must understand the rock on which the church is built. And that rock is Christ, his life, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And so with that as a backdrop, probably one of the first or earlier gospels was probably the Gospel of Mark. Mark was related to Barnabas, was a cousin of Barnabas, and could have been a cousin relative of Peter. But it's believed by most of the scholars that Mark got the information for his gospel from his conversation and his dialogue with Peter. He was not one of the apostles. He was a young man, and he presents himself in the Gospel of Mark, as we will see later. But he probably got most of the stories, most of the messages about Jesus as he was instructed and as we learn from the Apostle Peter. Now, understanding what Mark's purpose is important because each of the gospel writers have a different primary audience that they're writing to. And so in Mark's gospel, Mark has in mind a non-Jewish audience. Mark is writing to the Gentile world. And in particular, Mark is writing to the Roman Gentile world because the Roman Gentile world was the dominant world power at the time that Mark is writing his gospel. As a matter of fact, Rome ruled the known world at this time. And they had soldiers occupied Jerusalem because, as I said earlier, Jerusalem was not an independent sovereign state, but they were under the jurisdiction, the domination, and the control of the Roman government. And so Mark now has embraced this gospel. He believed in the power of this gospel to change, to transform individuals' lives. And he also believes that this gospel can change and transform the Roman Empire. And so Mark is led by the Lord to pen this gospel of Jesus Christ from this perspective. I'm right into this non-Jewish world, so I'm not going to deal with a lot of the Jewish jargon. I'm not going to go into the genealogy of Jesus because that would mean nothing to the Romans that he has the legal right to be the heir as a king of the Jews, because I'm not presenting Jesus as the king of the Jews to the Romans. I'm presenting him as the savior of the world, as the only hope that a person can be saved. In this polytheistic Roman Empire, where they worship many different gods, polytheism, many gods, he said, I'm going to elevate Jesus Christ as the only begotten Son of the living God, as the only hope of salvation. So that's Mark's main theme, his main idea. Now, Mark is an interesting convert of Jesus Christ because Mark was converted as a young man. And Mark was attached to Barnabas and to Peter and later to the Apostle Paul. And when the Apostle Paul and Barnabas embark on their first missionary journey, John Mark accompanies them on that journey. But Paul's travels were difficult. It was hard. Their times were placed on unsanctified fast. They weren't intending to fast, but there was no food. There were times they were ran out of cities, trying to preserve and save their very lives because of the hostility that was generated in many of the cities that Paul and Barnabas went to by the Jews that were there. And this got just too hard for John Mark. He was not expecting this. He was expecting that people would receive this good news of the gospel and that they would be saved and revival would break out from city to city. And so Mark was somewhat disillusioned and he becomes discouraged and his spirit is broken. And Mark basically says to Paul and Barnabas, I'm going home to my mom. And so he leaves Paul and Barnabas in the middle of the first missionary journey and he returns home. And so later we find that when Barnabas and Paul were getting ready to embark on their second missionary journey, that Barnabas wanted to bring along John Mark, his cousin, his young disciple. And he felt that they should show some compassion and some forgiveness and some understanding. But Paul, at that time in his ministry, was a bit uncompromising. And Paul said, no, absolutely not. We could not depend on him when we needed to depend on him. He defected. He left us in a hostile situation, not knowing what the outcome would be. We can't trust him. And so the Bible says there was this big dispute between Barnabas and Paul, these two preeminent leaders of the early church. And the dispute was so intense that they could not reconcile their differences. And finally, they decided it would be best that we part company. Even the most spiritual people don't always agree. Even the most godly people sometimes can come to forks in the road where they cannot reconcile their differences. And so they agreed that they would depart. And Barnabas took John Mark, and they went back to Cyprus. And Paul took a man by the name of Silas that became his traveling companion till he would pick up another young mentee by the name of Timothy. And so Mark now goes back, and we have every reason to believe that Mark learned this lesson of the importance of discipline and courage and tenacity and stick-to-itiveness and resolve. Because when Paul came to the end of his ministry, as recorded in 2 Timothy, and he is in that Roman jail awaiting his final sentence of death that had been passed down by the Roman emperor. And Paul was expecting to be beheaded in just a matter of days, possibly. And he writes to his son in the ministry, Timothy. And among the things he told Timothy, he says, bring John Mark because he's profitable for me in the ministry. And so somewhere along the way, Mark learned his lesson. And so for all of us, we can learn lessons from our failures. As a matter of fact, the most profound and the most insightful lessons that we will ever learn, we will learn those lessons where we have failed. And so Mark learned the lesson in his failure. And so he becomes a very strong, a very influential person in the New Testament, so much so that God found him faithful enough that he would entrust to him the sacred task of penning one of only four Gospels of Jesus Christ. Now, as I said, John Mark is writing to the Roman world, and so the Roman world was different from the Jewish world. The Roman world and the Roman literature, it dealt with graphic, forceful, dramatic realism. And so Mark knew, if I'm going to get the attention of the Romans, I must show that Jesus is a man with power, man on a mission, and I can get bogged down in a lot of details. And so one of the most predominant words in the book of Mark is the Greek word ekthous. And ekthous is translated in the New Testament immediately or straightforward. And you find that word used repeatedly over and over in Mark's gospel. Mark was saying Jesus was a man on the mission. He was doing things spontaneously. He was doing things as if he was literally on a mission. Things were happening around his ministry. And so Mark records a lot of the activities of Jesus. And so Mark is less concerned about the deep, weighty theology and the deep, weighty teaching. He's showing that Jesus Christ is the servant of God with power that can bring consequence in many different situations. And so Mark moves his gospel forward with a sense of urgency. And he records the events like he was an eyewitness. And in many cases, he wasn't an eyewitness, but he records them like he was an eyewitness because he's had this eyewitness testimony of the Apostle Peter, so he records them vividly in a way that would arouse and hold people's attention. So with that as a backdrop, Mark opens his gospel with these words, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. And so Mark just identifies him initially as the Son of God. And as I said earlier, he does not go into the genealogy of Jesus, because for the Roman audience, that would have been irrelevant. They want to know, is he the Son of God? If he is, does he have power? And from where does his power derive? So the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophets. And so Mark connects Jesus, this Son of God, to the Old Testament prophets. And Mark is saying that Jesus is the fulfillment of the Old Testament. And that's also important for us to kind of understand how the New Testament basically conceals much of what's in the Old Testament. And one of the things that gives the New Testament its veracity, its authority, its credibility, is the fact that there are Old Testament prophecies that appear to be minute and that appear to be insignificant that are fulfilled in the New Testament in the life and ministry of Jesus of Nazareth. And one of those Old Testament passages and concepts has to do with the idea that the prophets could see things in the future through the course of time which were veiled even to them that they wrote about, and then God would bring these things to pass in the future. Now back up, if you would, since it's not far away, you can flip back past Matthew, back to the book of Malachi, and we can see one of these Old Testament passages that points directly to the Lord Jesus Christ and to the forerunner, John the Baptizer, whom we will talk about in just a moment. In Malachi chapter 4, you find these words. It says, "Remember the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded him in Horeb for all of Israel with the statutes and the judgments. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord." Now the passage here in Malachi 3:5 that references the coming of Elijah the prophet is a veiled prophetic word really referring to John the Baptist, that one would come in the spirit of Elijah. One would come with the carriage of Elijah, and one would come with a bold proclamation about God, just as Elijah was, and that coming one who came before Elijah would come before the dreadful day, before the day of doom and before of judgment. So before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord, and he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to the fathers, lest I come and strike the earth with a curse. And so if you turn back again to Mark chapter 1, he says, "As it is written in the prophets, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." And so the first thing we see here in this preparation for Christ's ministry, or the preparation for the ministry of the servant of the Lord, is his forerunner. His forerunner. And as I shared on Wednesday night with the Wednesday night Bible class, one of my favorite biblical characters is John the Baptist. It's John the Baptizer. He is an enigmatic individual, much like Elijah of the Old Testament. You read about Elijah in the Old Testament, he just kind of catapults on the scene. We don't know where he really comes from, what his origin is, where he derives from. He just catapults on the scene as this powerful, authoritative, courageous prophet, thundering, "Thus saith the Lord." And so in Mark's gospel, John the Baptist appears the same way. But because of the other biblical writers, we have a little bit more background on John the Baptist. And we are particularly indebted to Luke. For in Luke's gospel, Luke gives us, in those early chapters in the gospel of Luke, he gives us more detail and background about John the Baptist. And we know that John the Baptist's father was a man by the name of Zacharias, who was a priest. And his mother was a woman by the name of Elizabeth, who was a cousin of Mary, the mother of Jesus. And so we know that from Luke's writings. And so we know this nexus that God had between John the Baptist and between the Lord Jesus Christ. And from Luke's writing, we know that Mary visited Elizabeth after Mary had conceived the child of the Holy Spirit, and that Elizabeth at the time was carrying John the Baptist. He's about 6 months in his mother's womb. And when Elizabeth heard that Mary was pregnant with child, the Christ child, the Bible says that the baby in her womb, John the Baptist, leaped and was filled with the Holy Spirit. And so we know that from Luke's writing that John was consecrated unto the Lord, to be the servant of the Lord. As a matter of fact, Luke gives us a little more detail about John the Baptist, that God, through the angel Gabriel, had given instruction to John's father, Zacharias, and his mother, that John would be a Nazarite from birth. And to be a Nazarite was the highest vow that a Jew could take. And it was symbolized by the fact that they would never cut their hair, razor would never come to their head. They would never drink any strong, intoxicating drink. They would always be guided and led by the Holy Spirit. They would never allow themselves to be in any way inebriated on the influence of anything but the Spirit of God. And they would never touch anything that was dead. They were the prophet of God that was speaking life. And that was the vow that symbolized the Nazarite's vow. Remember in the Old Testament, there was another young man who was to be a Nazarite from birth. And there were many, but one in particular, the strongest of them all, the strongest of strong men, the he of he men. And that was Samson. And Samson was supposed to be a Nazarite. A razor was never to come to his head. He was never drink any strong drink. He was to never touch anything dead. And Samson violated all of his vows. He violated all of his vows. He drunk strong drink. He was often inebriated. He went and stuck his hand in the carcass of a dead lion to get the honey out of it so he could satisfy his sweet tooth. And then he played with his vow. He misunderstood that his power and his strength was not in his hair. I keep trying to tell people that hair is overrated. It's overrated. It's overrated. His power was not in his hair. His power was in his vow, and it came from God. And his hair, not allowing it to be cut, was a symbol of his vow to God. And then he played with his vow to God with his head on Delilah's lap. And he played with her, and he joked with her about where his strength was. And he finally told her it was in his hair. If his hair was cut, he'd be like any other man. And the Bible says she cut off his locks. And the Bible said this, to show you that the power was not in his hair, she cut his hair off, and he didn't know that his power was gone. And so when the Philistines came in, and Delilah said, Samson, the Philistines be upon you. The Bible said that Samson jumped up and he shook himself like he always did and he flexed his muscles and he did not know that his power was gone. He had broken that final part of the vow, and in so doing, he had totally cut himself off from the power of God. And so now his power was gone and he was like any other man. And they blinded him, they plucked his eyes out, and they took him down to the mill, and they hooked him up like a beast of burden so he could grind at the mill. You know the story. But even in his death, Samson prayed a simple prayer, because the real gifts and callings of God are without repentance. And so in his death, Samson prayed and asked the Lord, Lord, just let me experience your power one more time. And the power of the Lord came upon Samson, and he was able to dislodge the pillars that supported the temple of the Philistines' idol gods, and the temple collapsed. And in his death, Samson actually killed more Philistine enemies than he did during his life. But he was a Nazarite that violated his vow. In contrast, John the Baptist was a Nazarite's Nazarite. As a matter of fact, John went to the extreme with his vow. Here this man who was born in a family of privilege. His father was a priest. And so John himself would have been trained to be a part of the priesthood, which meant he would not have had to work because they were responsible for taking care of the priests so they could give themselves to the ministry of the temple. He would have had the best theological, spiritual education that money could afford around the brightest minds of the day, because the brightest minds in Israel, in Jerusalem, were those, the priests and the high priests and the religious leaders. They were the brightest minds. So he would have been exposed to the brightest spiritual minds, the brightest theological minds, and the brightest intellectual minds of the day while he was being trained by his father. Now, the text doesn't tell us when John chose to assume his ministry, we're not really quite sure. But we do know that John basically rejected everything that he could have had as his father's heir and as his father's son, that he might assume the mantle that God had for him, the prophetic mantle, the prophetic role that God had for him. I say to you young people and you middle-aged and older people as well, if we are open to what God has for us, if we are open for it, we'll be amazed at the spiritual, theological, spiritual anointing that God will grant to us to do that which he's called us to do when we're walking in the footsteps that God has ordered for us. And that's why I tell you young people, pray now. Ask the Lord, what would you have me to do? Go to school and study as hard as you can, learn as much as you can, to try to expand your mind as far as you can possibly expand it so that you can be open to do what God has for you to do and can stand in any arena that God wants you to stand in and articulate using the vernacular of that particular arena, but bringing to bear the principles and the standards of the kingdom of God. And so John had the whole package, but God had a specific ministry for him. And so he is described simply, it's just a voice, just a voice crying in the waste howling wilderness. If there's something that's needed today, there's a need for voices that are clear, that are clarion, that are specific, that are able to speak God's truth with clarion, clarity, and accuracy and precision, because there is massive spiritual confusion that exists today in the society, where very well-educated people are having difficulty distinguishing right from wrong, difficulty understanding what really does God's word have to say about family and about marriage and about divorce and about raising children and about the work ethic. These things that we used to know and understand, now we are confused about it. But there are so many different voices out there, so many different pipers that have access to our minds through the media, printed media, through electronic media, and through video media, then now we're really kind of confused and we're not really sure. Is the word of God the final truth? Is it the authority? Can it provide the spiritual ballast that I need to be able to withstand the onslaught of different ideologies and philosophies that's going to be espoused in the society? And so John is raised up by the Lord, and you got to understand there has been no society yet, maybe until our society, that could have matched the Roman society in its polytheism, in its moral decadence, in its absolute wickedness, in terms of there being confusion that existed, where the emperors themselves were very often either pedophiles and or homosexuals. This is not anything new. And they espoused it where bestiality was practiced in the Roman Empire. There was extreme decadence and wickedness and perversion that existed. Even in their religious rituals very often, they had temple prostitutes where they believed they reached to a new level of spiritual interaction with the gods by engaging in the most gross immorality. There's nothing new under the sun, ladies and gentlemen. We just have the technology to videotape it, to digitize it, to post it on U-Book, to send out on Facemail, and to tweet it. They just did it and lived it and practiced it in real time. That's the type of society that Jesus Christ was born into, and that's the type of society that John the Baptist was raised up to prophesy to. Now I'm going to get a little bit ahead of myself, but you know the story. John lost his head because he couldn't keep his mouth shut when he came to telling the truth. And he said to Herod, it is not only illegal, it is immoral and against the law of God. You've had your brother Philip killed so you can have his wife. And Herodias, this adulterous wife, was able to coach her daughter into convincing Herod to deliver John the Baptist's head on a platter. So the most powerful, most spiritual, most influential, most godly man of the day, second to Jesus of Nazareth, had his head chopped off simply because he told people the truth to try to save their souls. So John was just this voice. Don't ever underestimate your voice. Don't ever underestimate the power of your voice to speak words that can bless, words that can encourage, words that can uplift, words that people act on and that can change people's destinies and future because you articulated words. So John didn't have a TV program, a radio program, a public relations agent. He didn't have a mega ministry. All he had was a voice that he lifted up. So it simply says the voice of one crying in the wilderness. Prepare the way of the Lord and make his paths straight. So John had a voice. He was prophesied that he would come by Malachi, prophesied by Isaiah, in Isaiah 40, verse 1. Now look at this forerunner in just a few more moments and we'll be through. Look at his declaration. Verse 4, John came baptized in the wilderness and preached a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And all the land of Judea and those from Jerusalem went out to him and were all baptized by him in the Jordan River, confessing their sins. So John's declaration was simply this. You got to repent. You got to turn away from the way you think, and you got to turn toward God. You got to repent. You got to realize that the way you think, you're thinking from a mind that is fallen. You're thinking from a mind that is in opposition to God's ways. You got to repent. So John's message was simple. You must repent. Now, the Bible is replete with a theme about the love of God. And we understand the love of God. And that's why Paul writes in the book of Romans, it's the goodness of God that leads us to repentance. And so we do people a tremendous disservice when we tell them, no, you don't have to change. Yeah, you do got to change. And the change must first start in your mind. You got to change your mind and realize you're going in the wrong direction. You're on the wrong road. And the only way that you can get on the right road is to repent toward God. So John said, repent. Amen. Repent. And the Bible says that the people repented. These are religious people. They were not all immoral people. Many of them were moral and they were religious, but they had concluded that they could get to God based on their own works, based on their own merit, based on trying to keep the law. So to them, John was saying, you got to repent and realize that you're wrong and thinking that you can satisfy God through your own good works. He says, repent. And the Bible says that many people came. John said, repent. For the remission, for the cancellation, for the forgiveness of sins. And all the land of Judea and those from Jerusalem went out to him. Now, Mark has a tendency to exaggerate just a bit. When he says all, he just meant a whole lot of people. He didn't mean every single person. He says, but it was a bunch of people. They're from all walks of life, every social, economic background, spiritual people, unspiritual people, young, old, middle-aged. It was a whole bunch of folk because they was attracted to this voice telling them they could be made right with God. So that was his declaration. Repent for remission of sins, forgiveness, and be baptized. Identify with God. In this 21st century, people don't really understand the importance of Christian baptism. Christian baptism is an identification with God. You're saying, I'm identifying with Jesus Christ in his death, in his burial, and in his resurrection. And I'm putting all of my hope to get to heaven. I'm placing in Christ. And I'm doing it publicly. People today don't understand the importance of church attendance. Church attendance is really important because church attendance is a way that you baptize yourself every week with Jesus Christ. You identify every week with Christ, with his body, with his people, with his work, with his physical, visible representation on the earth. Christ came and identified with us by being baptized. We identify with him by being baptized. And then by identifying with his body, with the church. And that's not TV church. That's not the electronic church. That's not the Facebook church. No, that's the real church where people with flesh and blood and bone and struggles like you show up at. That's the church we need to be a member of. So as we wrap this up, his declaration was repent. His dress, verse 6. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and with a leather belt around his waist. That's a strange looking outfit. Looked like a wild man, uncouth, unsophisticated, not trying to draw attention to himself, but he wanted people to be identified with the message that he was proclaiming. And so in John's declaration and in John's dress, he was denying himself and he was denying the world system as being corrupt and unable to bring about the salvation that people needed. In his dress and then in his diet. He ate locusts and wild honey. I don't know what kind of diet that was. I'll tell you what the diet that was. It was a diet of the poor. It was a diet of the poor. The poor often, their diet was the locusts. It was the wild honey. It was an abundance. The honeybees created honey in abundance, and the locusts, they were there in abundance. And so John, he identifies with the low. He identifies with the disenfranchised, with the empowered, with the poor. He identifies with the poor. Just as Jesus of Nazareth did when he preaches the inaugural sermon in Luke chapter 4, when he says, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. So in so doing, John would demonstrate that the gospel was not held hostage by socioeconomic class or by political power. That it really was whosoever will, let him come. And that the gospel has the power to save a person on the very lowest rung of the socioeconomic ladder and all the way up. So if you can save from the bottom, you can save all the way up to the top. And so this was his identification, his dress, his diet, and then lastly, his directive. His directive. Verse 6, and then John was clothed with camel's hair and with a leather belt around his waist. He ate locusts and wild honey, and he preached saying, there comes one after me who is mightier than I, whose sandal strap I'm not worthy to stoop down and loose. I indeed baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. That was John's directive. There's one that's coming, mightier than me. I'm not worthy to unlash the sandals that's strapped, but he comes after me, and that is our directive. I might not look like much, I may not sound like much, but there's one that I represent that is mightier than me. I may not be able to conjugate all the verbs, I may not be able to articulate the deep theology, but I represent one that is mightier than me. That is our message. That is our directive. We represent one that has the power to save and to transform and to change people's lives. We represent one that is able to save the drug addict, the drug dealer, the prostitute, the pimp, the homeless person. We represent the one that is able to save and transform the life of the one who's a swindler and a scandal. We represent him. There's one that is mightier than we are. And John believed that. And as we get over in John's life, we're going to find something that's really interesting. That John believed all of this by faith. John had not yet witnessed the power of Christ. He had not saw dead people raised. He had not yet saw blinded eyes open. He had not saw mute tongues that were loose, deaf ears that were able to. He had not witnessed any of that. As a matter of fact, John himself had never performed one single miracle.
But he believed the prophetic word that was preached by the prophets. And he believed there was one that was coming mightier than he that was able to be able to do the supernatural and save to the uttermost. And so John declared what he believed. That's what we're called to do. To keep on saying what we believe. What we believe to be true. What God says that is true. What is recorded that is true. But we also have, as I've shared with you before, we have the personal witness of our own testimonies, the story that we know of what God has done for us and what God has done for members of our family, what God has done from people that we know. And we must tell it with conviction, with courage, with passion, with pathos. I know in whom I believe, and I know he's able to save who will ever call upon him. Amen. Well, this is the forerunner. And in a way, we should pray and ask the Lord that the spirit of John the Baptist will fall on us. Because in a sense, we become the forerunners of Christ in his second coming. John was his forerunner at his first coming to present him in his earthly ministry. So we can learn some lessons from John the Baptizer to declare the word of the Lord without compromise and to tell what we know and what we experienced and what we believe to be true. Let's bow together, shall we? Father, we thank you for your forerunner, John the Baptizer. We thank you for his courage, for his conviction, for his compassion. And we thank you, Lord, for his faithfulness to what you called him to do. And we thank you for the witness that we have to encourage us. Strengthen your people today. Encourage your people today. Lift their spirits today. Open the heart of that man, that woman, that boy, that girl that's never come to faith in Christ. Maybe today they might cry, "What must I do to be saved?" And save them for your own glory. In Jesus' name. Every head bowed, every eye closed. If there's someone here today that you've heard that message, that you need to repent, you need to change your mind and turn toward the Lord and call on the Lord for salvation and ask for his forgiveness. Is there one here today? If so, just raise your hand right where you are. In so doing, you said, "I just want to be saved. I want to know the Lord. I want to know that my sins have been remitted, that they have been forgiven." Is there one here today? One here today who longs to be saved, to know they're forgiven. Is there one? Maybe you already are saved and you just want to sort of re-surrender to the Lord today. Just re-surrender. Say, "Lord, I belong to you and you belong to me and I just want to serve you. And I want you to order my footsteps." Is there one? Maybe you already are saved and you're looking for a church to unite with, to be baptized into. We'd love for you to unite with us. Become a part of this church family, this church body. Let's pray together. Let's work together. Let's struggle together. Let's rejoice and celebrate together. Let's bear one another's burdens together. Won't you unite with us today? Become a part of the Grace Bible Church family. Is there one? If not, let us prepare for our benediction. I just want to remind you of one announcement. Brother Danny and some of his colleagues here at the church are planning this trip next Saturday, this coming Saturday, to Cincinnati, Kings Island. And so you need to get your money in by Wednesday. So some of you reserved your seat. And so if you plan on going and you haven't gotten your money to Brother Danny, do so by Wednesday, and so that we can have everything squared away and nailed down. And I think the bus is planning on departing at 6 o'clock. That's in the morning. 6 o'clock a.m., that's in the morning, okay? And so an idea of they will head straight to right above Cincinnati at Kings Island, and then, of course, come back that night. So I think we have all the seats reserved and accounted for. So if you plan on not going, then let Danny know, because there are some other people who are interested in going, and he wants to accommodate those who wanted to go and there were not seats. And remember, we kind of prioritized this. The priority was, first of all, the kids who were fairly faithful in Sunday school and or Wednesday night and or church. So it's the kids who are our children here involved in the ministry here. They're the ones who got first choice. And then, of course, the chaperones have to chaperone the kids. And then after that, we added, whosoever will, let him come with the money. So it is a real good price. What's the price? Now, what's the ticket if you go up on your own? It's $53 if you pay for the ticket.